All right, everyone. Welcome, welcome. Okay, so this is going to be my masterclass on Kain. Kain is a super fun piece in the book Marimba Technique Through Music by Mark Ford. This piece utilizes the double vertical stroke. So double verticals are when you play two mallets at the same time. And one of the things about this stroke, you know, that maybe we don't think about as young players is actually making sure that both of the notes strike at exactly the same time. It's easy to be just a little bit sloppy and kind of think that we're doing that when actually there might be a little bit of a flam effect. So you want to pay really close attention to your right hand when you're first learning this stroke. And make sure that both notes are actually striking at the same time. So that's number one. Now, the second thing about it is that we might actually want to overbalance one of those notes and not have them be even in volume. So I'd encourage you, striking at the same time, and then try to voice out the upper note more, and then the lower note. And how you're going to do that is just by kind of tightening your grip on whichever side of the hand you want to voice, and then in the right, or the mallet four. So a little exercise that you can work on there, just to really work on control. I'm big on control, and you know, being intentional about what you're doing helps your accuracy. It helps the flow of the piece. It helps make sure that you're bringing out melodic lines when you need to. So we'll get into that a little bit later in this piece for sure. Okay, so we'll just start right at the beginning. You can see this piece is kind of divided into, let's say it's four sections. So your first section is from the beginning to measure 15, and then 15 all the way to 24 is section two, and 24 to 34 is section three, and then the opening theme comes back at measure 35, and then we're out to the end. So, looking at that, I kind of have a good idea what's going on in the piece now, and let's go ahead and dig in. The right hand does what's called an ostinato. Ostinato means a repeated rhythmic pattern, or just something that kind of grounds you in rhythm. It can have melodic function to it, or it could just be as simple as one single note. So in this hand, right, and then we're going to try to keep this hand really, really low. Now, from a learning perspective, I don't even work on the right hand when I kind of take a look at the music and say, oh, okay, you know, it's just playing quarter notes. I really try to figure out how to learn a piece effectively. So I'm not even going to touch that anymore. Now I kind of know what it's doing. In the left hand, with the double vertical stroke, because it's both mallets going down, it's really easy to play this opening like this. And you play down into the bar. I would encourage you not to do that because there's a lot of things that happen that produce undesirable sounds when you're using so much velocity and driving down into the bar like that. So instead, I would try to make a really nice full stroke off of the bar and keep it nice and relaxed as you move from note to note. To be nice and fluid. Once you add the right hand in, this becomes even more important because you're going to want to do things like this where one hand goes up and one hand goes down. So like on this part, right, and keeping this and keeping that left hand really flowing is very important. So let's go ahead and hear a little bit of what that looks like then from the beginning. Left hand note in measure 8 be the loudest note of that phrase, and then the right hand begins immediately soft. Okay, so you also have left hand melody from from the beginning until measure 9, and then the right hand takes the melody. So I'll start at measure 7, but we really want to hear this shift in focus from left hand now to right hand. Is supposed to be focusing on helps to present a nice coherent musical statement, right? And that's part of Mark Ford's method in writing this piece, is to make sure that you're cognizant of that switch, right? Now, in some places it's really clearly delineated, like measure 2. Okay, measure 2, actually distinct dynamics, okay, between both of the hands here. And then not so much at measure 9. But I think that the point is to emphasize that moving line. So you'll definitely want to make sure you do that. Okay, I noticed that a lot of people have trouble at measure 13 actually getting through this 7/8 accurately. So if you don't, good for you. If you do, take it really, really slow. And remember that each quarter has 2 8th notes in it. And I would group it in your head like this. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1. Just count through that a couple of times till you get very, very comfortable making that switch. But there should be no break in rhythm in the eighth note. Okay, and then that sets you into the next section. So it should be, you know, fairly exciting when you get to this shift, and that 7/8 should really kind of throw everybody off, because we've had this, you know, groove intense, like it says from the beginning, and all of a sudden it's like, whoa, 7/8, crazy. Okay, and then we're back into groove. Now, so moving into this second section here, the legato. So what does legato mean? You'll notice that it's slurred, and anytime that you have a slur, that could mean a couple of things, right? Number one, it could mean that you're supposed to play all those notes smooth and connected. Okay, well, that's kind of hard when you play an instrument that creates all of its sound by attack. All right, so we want to be thinking about using lots of weight and really trying to get the warmest sound possible as we play this. So keep your mallet head low and let the weight of the mallet do all the work for you, which will create a big contrast from how you did the beginning section, right? With a little more velocity, kind of a more heavy feel. This is super smooth. And then you switch to mallet 4. Okay, to do that next part. Now, if you've never done this kind of 3/2 hemiola, so I'm looking at measure 16, all right? A hemiola is when you have a rhythm that does not fit into its native rhythmic grouping. So we, but it continues over and over. So you have normally either quarter notes, eighth notes, sixteenths in 4/4 time. Here we have a triplet, which would be more indicative of something that you would find in 12/8. So the fact that those two overlay, that creates your hemiola. I would practice doing this first. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, and 3, 1, 2, and 3. So when you do that, that makes the right hand the focus, which initially is probably what you want to do because that has your melodic line. 1, 2, and 3. Sorry. 1, 2, and 3, 1, 2, and 3. The problem with doing it that way is that's not how it fits into the broader rhythm in the piece here, because we are in 4/4. So it's actually better to count this more like you're in 12/8 when you get to this spot. 1, 2, and 1, 2, and 1, and 2, and 1, 1, and 2, and 3, and 4, and 1. Okay? that is two different ways that you can go about learning this. One from the very first time you're trying to learn how to do this rhythm, and then one when you're trying to figure out how this fits into the broader scheme. So essentially, measure 15 is like it's in 4/4, and then measure 16 is like it's in 12/8. The pulse is the same, but you're dividing your beat a little bit differently. Instead of two parts per beat in measure 15, 1 and 2 and 3 and 4, and now you're going 1 and a 2 and a 3 and a 4 and a 1. So, little challenging there. Maybe I'll have to do a separate video with some diagrams on how to break this down if you still have trouble. But hopefully you can listen to it a few times, use those two demos that I gave you, and that will help you. Okay, so I'll play this section for you. 24, we now have a different hemiola. This hemiola is the 4 over 3 hemiola. So this one, I like to use a mnemonic for this. That's something that you say to help you get the rhythm, which is pass the gosh darn spinach. Pass the gosh darn spinach. Okay, there's probably some other ones that you might hear out there. Pass the gosh darn spinach. Pass the gosh darn spinach. But the better way to do this is actually just to count through the rhythm. There's only three possible interactions. One is where your left hand plays a downbeat and your right hand plays on the and. So that's like beat 2 of measure 24. Measure 24, beat 2 goes 2 and. The next one is 3E, 3E, and then the last one is together, 4. So those are the only three ways that it happens. You're either going 2 and, 3E, or together, right? So I would look through each one of those and figure out which it is. And you can tell by the rest that precedes the note. When it's an eighth note rest that precedes it, it's a 1 and or 2 and. And then when it has a 16th note rest, it's 2E or 3E, depending where it falls. And then the last one is together. So mark each one of those in there, and you get this. 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. Sorry, notes. 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 1 and 2 and 3 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 4 and 1 and 2 and 3. Okay, sorry about that, Miss G sharp in there. Trying to count through the whole thing for you, which I do recommend that you learn how to do. Count your part as you play it. Really helps with accuracy. It's a little bit of extra work at the beginning, but pretty soon you won't have to think about it so much. Okay, so not too much else there as soon as you can master that rhythm. One more trick in the right hand here. So you have this D to the G sharp, right? And then you're here, so you're kind of spread out a little bit. I like to keep the right hand in this orientation when I move down to the A and the D. You can put the A on the bottom beating spot of the bar, and then the D on the top beating spot of the bar. And then that way you don't have to do this every time and turn your hand back. Just leave it in one position here. Okay, whatever the rhythm is there, but just an example. Okay, now we have an extended period of this kind of 3/2 hemiola, forte piano. Step out, back up. difference here at the end is that now you have the introduction of the single independent strokes in the second measure of each one. One, two, three, one, two, three. Try to go for that last low octave G there. Either way, I find that the trick to really making this better for you is where you look and when you look. So just kind of breaking down the last measure. Okay, here I'm looking at the left hand, you know, the right hand's still doing this ostinato. As soon as I play this next left hand note, I'm already looking down to that low G, and I'm gonna move right over that low G and D so that I don't have to look at this hand again. It's ready to play. You play the upper note, and then you're looking here so that you can strike that note. So in slow motion, I'm already looking to the left. Now I'm looking back at the right hand, and then they strike. Up to speed. Okay, so it happens very quickly. But that efficiency in where you're looking is really important if you want to go for that low octave. Otherwise, plan to have it sound like this every time. Okay, so watch for the notes that you're supposed to hit and always plan ahead. You want to anticipate where your hands need to be.